Hey, I'm Sean, and I'm going to talk to you all about Satoshi Kon's brilliant debut feature film, Perfect Blue. Unfortunately for me, I chose one of the most convoluted and perplexing films on the list, and I won't be able to mention all the great aspects of the film, but let's continue anyway. Okay, so just some general info. Perfect Blue is a Japanese animated horror film from 1997. It was directed by Satoshi Kon and written by Sadayuki Murai. Murai adapted the screenplay from Yoshikazu Takeuchi's novel, Perfect Blue: Complete Metamorphosis. We're going to skip over the synopsis and head right on into the director. Satoshi Kon actually started out as a semi-popular manga artist before he got into the TV and film industries. He was hired on to work as an animator for Roshin Z, a 1991 film, and eventually worked his way up to being the screenwriter and art director for Magnetic Rose, the first of three short films in the 1995 anthology film Memories. Kon went on to write and direct Millennium Actress in 2001, a film about a TV interviewer and an actress that travel through her memories and acting career. Tokyo Godfathers in 2003, a film about three homeless people who find a newborn in the trash and their journey to find its parents. And Paprika in 2006, a film about a machine that allows for people to enter others' dreams. Some common themes within these films include identity and perception versus reality. Both of these are explored in Perfect Blue, as Mima basically goes through an identity crisis as her perceptions and reality become increasingly blurred. His films often tinker with duality in every way possible. His filmography has inspired the likes of Hollywood directors, such as Darren Aronofsky and Christopher Nolan. Unfortunately, Kon passed away in 2010 due to pancreatic cancer. However, his legacy lives on. So the major question in my mind before I watched this for the first time a few years ago was, how can an animated movie be scary? Well, let's analyze this question, taking Perfect Blue into consideration. So to me, the main aspect that makes this scary is the blending of perception and reality. In my mind, the scariest things are those that are filled with uncertainty. It causes the mind to become anxiety-ridden and make it wander into the darkest places imaginable. This fear is combined with Mima's perspective. Seeing everything through Mima's eyes puts us on the same level as her. We know nothing more than she does, which in this case is barely anything. The blending of perception and reality is achieved through excellent and clever transitions throughout the film. We'll look at an example of this later. Now, even after my first viewing, teenage me could have assured you that horror isn't confined to regular movies. In fact, the world of animation may have the greatest advantage of all media when it comes to this specific genre, because its potential is limitless. Books and podcasts can be scary just like movies, but the combination of audio and video creates something special. However, normal films are limited to the real world, while animated films are limited only by the artist's imagination. So anything could happen to anyone in any way in the world of animation, which I think is pretty neat. Another reason I think Perfect Blue is scary is how realistic the potential danger is. Stalking and serial murders aren't necessarily common, but they definitely happen. The same goes for mental deterioration. People can and absolutely have gone crazy before. Grounding the immediate danger in realism makes the film feel more personal and have more of an actual threat to the audience. Unfamiliarity is also another big aspect of this film. The characters themselves are thrown into unfamiliar worlds, particularly Mima. Back in 1995, when this film was greenlit, the internet was basically brand new to consumers and was not considered mainstream. When Mima discovers her fan-made blog online, she enters a whole new world that she knew absolutely nothing about. Mima's ignorance of the internet ends up being a large part of her downward spiral and eventual mental breakdown. However, her new acting career is certainly another huge part of this. Mima enters an industry she knows little about, and she doesn't really take the time to learn much about it either, because she's basically guided by her agent and directors the entire way. This only added more fuel to the fire, as it becomes more difficult for her to distinguish her real life from the TV show she's acting in. Now the last thing. What is a horror film without its score? Probably not much. I would describe Perfect Blue's score as goosebump rendering paranoia. Unfortunately, I don't have much time or the qualifications to talk about this, but it's definitely worth a mention. Alright, let's move on to the scene. Unfortunately, I couldn't find it in Japanese with English subtitles, so you're just gonna have to deal with English dubbing.
In other news, today, the Economic Planning Agency announced a new Citizens Life Index that will indicate the overall Japanese standard of living and the individual's wealth.
It feels like I haven't seen you in a long time.
Well, I've been very busy lately. So, tell me, are you getting used to acting?
Mm-hmm. It's hard, but I guess it's what I decided to do.
You have become such a mature woman. And that's just great. Everyone seems to like the new Mima.
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't look like you agree. Mima, what is it? Are you being harassed by someone? I've been checking out your website. It's a bit much. You change your image a little bit, and they complain. I think it's better if you don't look at it.
Yeah. But maybe she is more like me than myself.
Mima?
My other self that I've now buried deep inside my heart. What if that other personality started acting out on its own?
It's all right. There's no way illusions can come to life.
Rumi!
Cut! Mima, dear, what the hell are you saying?
I feel like I'm gonna have nightmares about this line.
I'm sorry again.
What is it?
Nothing.
Once more from the top. All right, take two!
In other news, today, the Economic Planning Agency announced a new Citizens Life Index that will indicate the overall Japanese standard of living and the individual's wealth.
It's been a while, Rumi.
What are you talking about, Mima? I was just here yesterday.
What was yesterday? Was all that real?
What? Now that's weird. What's wrong with you? Oh my God, you're bleeding.
This blood. Rumi, is it real?
Mima.
I guess I went to Harajuku today.
You mean the murderer is just an illusion that she has simply created?
Yes. She fears an imaginary security guard and then superimposes that figure as a serial murderer of people that she has been affiliated with.
But Doctor, there's no way illusions can kill a person.
I know. But what if that illusion had possessed someone?
What? Possess?
You mean all those men that got murdered?
Were those that no longer had any use to her.
Alright, so this is, in my opinion, the most important scene in the movie. In it, Mima has completely lost control of her ability to distinguish between her perception and reality. Hours, possibly days, pass within a single transition. And since we are viewing the story through her lens, we are totally unsure about what is really happening. Mima also confirms to Rumi that her other self is no longer a vision, but rather a real being. This is Mima's ultimate breaking point in the film. This scene also deals with identity. Mima verifies her inner conflict with Rumi when she says that her other self is possibly more like me than myself. At this moment, she has two different identities, actress Mima and pop star Mima. And she doesn't know which one she wants to be. She's uncertain that becoming an actress was the right thing to do. Cham, her former pop group, got a single on the top 100 list, while she hardly gets any screen time as an actress. This inner conflict is causing her to mentally disintegrate. This scene also has some interesting, somewhat on-the-nose dialogue. The TV show script is basically not so subtly hinting what is going on with Mima to the audience, only further confusing everyone in the process. Alright, I thought I'd end this by showing you my favorite shot of the film, which comes in the very beginning when Uchida acts as if he's holding Mima in the palm of his hand. I think it's beautiful imagery, and I think it means a lot to the overall story. So anyway, hopefully I made some smart, interesting points, and you can now all go back to hoarding all the toilet paper in the greater Louisville area.